Hello everyone, I'm Benjamin Dono. I work at RTE, Réseau Transport d'Électricité, the French Transmission Service Operator. And today I'm going to give the talk about organizing AI competitions to tackle future challenges of power system controls and open science initiatives. This talk is given in the context of the Linux Foundation Energy at the Spring Summit 2021. First, I'm going to introduce this talk by trying to motivate what AI can bring to power grids today. As some of you might know, power grids are really complex environments with lots of variability, lots of different things to monitor. And actually, in real time, some operators have the difficult task to make it run smoothly and avoid any incident possible. To help them do that, they have lots of applications which are displayed on lots of screens, and they have to monitor all of them to take the best decision at any given time. This is already a rather complex task today, but we anticipate that this will become more and more difficult. Why? Is because you might have heard it, but climate change is an issue today, and the power grid needs to contribute to reduce the impact on the climate. To do that, power grid needs to rely less on fossil fuels and grid expansion, which was some of the main traditional methods to solve problem of the power grids, and to allow the introduction of more renewable. And to do that, let's say, we need to be sustainable. Sustainable is a key, and future smart grid have to do better with less. And how to do that? Well, we can try to see if AI is a possible solution for this problem. We can approach the problem of AI and electricity in a different manner. For example, you might have know that blackouts are not things from the past. Blackouts occur really frequently, even today. The last example in date being the Texas, for example, a few weeks ago. So it's really difficult, and blackouts are complex phenomenon often caused by lots of things. And the idea here is, can AI help reduce the impact of the blackout and reduce their occurrences? So who can AI help the energy transition and the grid in general? To do that, and to try to see if AI was a possible solution, we decided to cast a series of competitions. In the next few slides, I will try to motivate why we did this choice. Our objectives for this competition was to put forward problematics related to real-time decision-making in power system. Because, well, you might know that it's kind of a niche problem. It doesn't attract a lot of people to work on it. So the more people work on it, the better quality the solution will be, of course. What we wanted to do was also to develop new open source benchmark. Why? Because power grid are safety critical environment, and if we cannot reproduce solution of others people, and if you cannot benchmark different kind of solution, we might adopt a wrong solution or a suboptimal solution, which again is not that great. Also, we want to attract new communities, especially the AI communities, which seems to be really active in certain area, but less active in others, and among these others is power system management. And finally, on the power system side, we also wanted to study new flexibilities, and especially the real-time control of topology. This competition, we think that they are a good way to do research, and this is motivated by here two examples. First, the ImageNet benchmark, which was one of the key ingredients of the deep learning renewal in the early 2010s, when the best submission to this problem based on to a problem based on ImageNet wins against traditional methods. And then you have the CAS competition, which drew more attention recently. and try to address the protein solving problem. And this problem has been solved, allegedly, by Google DeepMind in last year, in 2020, for example. So these two examples show that competition are a good way to promote research on different topics and to attract state-of-the-art companies or state-of-the-art labs to work on this problem, which are rather specific. So image processing on one side and a protein folding on the other side. What we want to achieve there is to connect the AI and power system community, which again today are rather distinct one. Power system don't really model the grid as models that are used by AI community, and AI community doesn't have lots of interest today in power system related issues, even though it starts to change a bit recently. And on the grid, from the power system side, we are interested in studying one new flexibility, which is the grid topology. The grid topology is interesting for different reasons. It's already possible to do it today. Switches are already installed. You don't have to install new equipment most of the time. So this is really interesting and sustainable. You don't have to do anything. It's not expensive. Opening and closing a switch can be done relatively easily and at the cost of pretty much nothing. But it has little research, unfortunately, today. You have other type of flexibility that are used on the grid. Electronic component, it draws lots of investment today, for example, HVDC power lines or storage unit and this kind of stuff. This is really interesting. It's once the equipment are installed, it's relatively cheap and it draws more and more research. So this is, let's say, a problem that is already shining to the community, and also the traditional way of solving congestion problem on power grid, it was to adapt load and generation. And this is relatively possible to do it today. Not everything, but most of things are possible. But on the other side, it's rather costly because you have to pay people to adapt their schedule. So it's not. Well, it can be more efficient and it draws lots of research. So again, this is not the target of the talk today. But of course, this is a really interesting flexibility that we need to keep using. So I'm going to focus on topology here, and the ecosystem that we develop focuses on topology because we think it's interesting and not always studied at its best potential. To make things maybe more concrete, the problem tackle is the following. So you have an agent, a controller, someone that will act on the power grid, take decisions, that receives a state, which is a grid state with flows on lines and all this kind of information. For example, here you have a power line that is on overflow, and it needs to take an action to decide what action to do and where. And then once he does that, he implements it on the grid, or let's say he transmits it to the environment, implemented on the grid, and you receive the next time step. So this is really the problem that is tackled. You have a power grid, you need to take a decision on this power grid, an action, and then you receive a new state, and of course you need to retake another action, etc., etc., until everything is done. And the interesting part, of course, is how do you choose actions and how AI can help choosing better actions. To do that, again, we decided to use an open science initiatives and to develop the Grid Alive lab. So here, each component of Grid Alive is open source, and you can already use part of it on GitHub. Basically, this lab is made of different modules that can be used together or not, and standard API. So each of these big arrows represents an API. And so you have an API for the agent. Okay, if you need to develop a new agent, you have to implement a certain API and that's it. You are free to choose whatever technology you want behind the scene. Same for the time series generation. So it allows the use of a real time series or a simulated time series, for example. Here, an example of this is Chronix to Grid package, which does simulate time series. Also, something that is really interesting for us is the possibility to change solvers and also the possibilities to change the visualization tools. So I already mentioned the agent part, the grid part. Now, if we focus more a bit on the solver, this is really important. Why? Because the solver might depend on the problem that you want to tackle. And of course, we want to be as generic as possible, so we don't want to enforce the use of any particular solver. And this is important. We will speak more about it a bit later. For the visualization, it is as important because Power Grid are really complex environment. You have lots of information that you need to look at to have the best decision. And so it's important for a human to have a good representation of the information available, what is used, how it can be used, and what is done. And this is why we developed the Grid2Vis package in this Grid Alive ecosystem. At the center of the Grid Alive ecosystem is the Grid2Up testbed platform. So it is a platform that allows to simulate the time. So you have it sends an observation, computes the action, sends another observation, etc., etc. And of course, it's already available on GitHub here. I will not enter into too much detail, but basically Grid2Up is itself very modular and it's split into four different independent modules. First, you have the data. So the data are typically the loads and the generation. But you can imagine also to put there any other type of data, for example, maintenance scheduled, wind and external temperature, etc., etc. You have the solver. Again, Grid2Up does not rely on any specific solver. It relies on a backend, which is an API to a solver, but the implementation of the solver is free. We provide two example, an API that used behind the scene Panda Power, and another one that used LightSim to Grid, which was developed specifically for this for the competition for speed. And the focus on the competition was the agent that could use any type of methods to take best decision. For example, they can use heuristics, they can use optimizers, they can use AI, etc., etc. Everything is possible in theory. And so having everything decoupled is interesting because it makes things decoupled. You have on one side the modeling of the problem, what is interesting and how people, what people can use to solve the problem. It decouples it from the Power Grid modeling. So is the model, the equation that the grid must satisfy, which is a research topic in itself. Really important. It also can deals with different security criteria. In real time, you might have some different security criteria. For example, N or N minus K in the case of a power system. It also put aside the problem solving. So now that you have a problem, what is the best method to solve it? Of course, if you do small internal research, you can only have a look at part of the possible candidate solution. Whether if you put a whole problem in the outside and that everyone can try to solve it, then you might end up with a better solution or not, but at least you will have better candidates. And finally, once you have lots of possible solutions, you can assess independently of especially the problem solving, the proposed solution on a reproducible benchmark, which is super interesting. So basically, what is this? Is that you can, with Grid2Up, make an experiment. So an experiment is basically you create time series, you create agent, you create an environment and a solver. of course, from example provided. And then you assess the performances of anything that you want. For example, if you want to benchmark solver, you can assess the performance of the solver. If you want to benchmark time series data, then you can use it to assess time series data, realisticness of time series data, for example. In the case of L2RPN, of the competitions that we did, we wanted to assess the performance of agent. So using this vocabulary of the experiment, basically we run one experiment for each agent that was submitted by each participant, and then we computed a score. And the step later on was just to select and to rank the agent based on this score. Of course, this is an example of what is possible to do. Another example, still, if you are interested in the control of power grid, again, is to tie the gap between academia and industry. For example, we can, on the industry side, model the real problem, provide the data and the use case, as well as the possible solution to solve the problem. What is possible, what is not possible. Then on the academia side, and here I say academia in a broad manner, I mean, a startup for me will be an academia, a manufacturer or a vendor of EMS, for example, can also participate into this kind of competition, no problem. And so these entities will address the problem and provide possible solutions. And finally, back to the industry that first framed the problem, then we can test the solution and pick the best one. This is interesting, especially because we don't need to share private sensitive data. We don't need to share simulator. We don't need to share real data, which are highly sensitive. But we can reuse the agent directly. I mean, it's the same agents running on different, slightly different data if we want the agent to work a bit. So this is really interesting. And I mean, if the problem is not to share, well, you can also address different type of problem. For example, you could have the same environment, or you could have the same solver if you want it, no problem. But the advantage is that you can have different type of things here. So quickly, what were the results of these challenges? So I will speak about the two challenges that were done during the NeurIPS conference. But before that, it's let's say a ramp up of different kind of challenges. It's a series of competitions that started in 2019 with a really small environment, and now we are at the interesting size, we think, for AI to be of any help for real operators, which is approximately the case IEEE 118, for example, which is an open source power grid. This competition drew lots of attention from lots of people belonging to lots of affiliation. So here you see some vendors, General Electric. You also see some research universities, so NYC, for example. Lots of people coming from lots of different type of affiliation, and that was really nice for us. We had more than 500 unique participants for our competition, coming from more than 60 affiliations. Some of them are here, but not everyone of them. The final leaderboard is this one, and what we can draw from what we can know for this leaderboard, what we can conclude, is that China is really dominant in the area. The best team, the four best team, which was the same, I mean, Binbin Chen and Gun Jietang was the same teams, they just used different accounts, was performing really well. These teams came from top-tier Chinese companies, for example, Huawei, and they used AI and heavily used AI, all of them. And this is really nice to see that we could attract top-performing companies of different countries. Here, specifically China. And to conclude, first, I want to thank all our collaborators. We were a lot to make it possible. I didn't do it myself, of course, and from lots of people. So RT, some startup and cohort, some research institute, etc., etc. So lots of people from different perspectives. And let's say the main takeaways is that we developed Grid2Up and the whole Grid Alive ecosystem to make experiments easy. Competitions are a good way to connect different communities, and they can push the research forward by merging different ideas, different promising ideas. You can, of course, stay tuned because competitions are still ongoing. And we will try to organize a new competition for the ICAPS conference in 2021. Thank you very much.
Hi, hello everyone. So I'm Benjamin Dono. I think most of you recognize me. Can you confirm that my microphone and video is working properly? Yes, okay, perfect. Nice. So I will try to answer the question in the Q&A tab. So the first question was about the were chips that I use, and actually when I say chip, it's from a TSO point of view. I mean, when you are performing redispatching or counter trading, for example, you have to pay the producers. When you want to do load shedding, you have to somehow pay the consumers for them to consume less. Whereas if you want to open or close switches, or at least that's the case in France, and I think in most European countries, then you don't have to pay anyone. So it's in this sense that it's that I say it's cheap. So yeah, it's cheap from a point of view, from a TSO point of view, but maybe not from from another point of view, for example, for producers or for consumers. Then there was another question about the interest of Chinese people. Yes, actually, for most of our participants, came from China. This might be because lots of advertisement has been done in China, for mainly from the one of the subsidiary of State Grid of China, which is Garena, that now does not exist anymore, but it was, let's say, a research lab of State Grid of China in the US, and they advertised a lot this competition, so maybe that's why we had a lot of Chinese participants. And I think it's a growing topic there, because they develop quite rapidly. I mean, China's grid is expanding a lot, and I think they are trying also to see if topology modification and AI is a possible solution for the problem. But I can only guess, because of course I don't know exactly what the State Grid of China has in mind. Okay. Yes. Okay. So the other question is another question for my previous answer about the cheap part. I think using topology is cheaper than other flexibilities, for example, load shedding or topology or redispatching. And the idea is that AI can bring better solution for topology. Basically, we think we made the bet, and we are trying to demonstrate that using topology will reduce the necessarily load shedding or, for example, redispatching that you need to do. So this is where AI come into play. It will help to perform a better topology maneuver, and so to use more the topology and more this flexibility on the grid. Okay. So the next question is about the gap between the Chinese participant and the other team. So as far as I know, every team used the same power grid solver, and it was fixed for the competition. Actually, it was Lighting to Grid, so an open source power flow that we connected to Grid2 grid to hub, sorry. So they all use the same. And probably what made the difference is that people from Huawei, for example, the winner, they used a lot of computational resources. I mean, Huawei is relatively big, and so that's probably one of the main reasons. Probably if, I don't know, Google, Amazon, Microsoft, or any other big player in the US, for example, had participate and had take interest in this competition, they would also have access to the same kind of power, and they might have competed more equally. But yes, unfortunately, or fortunately for them, let's say, they had more computational power, and so they did more, they were able to perform more, because this competition, the top performers used reinforcement learning, and probably it requires a lot and lots of data and power to train, at least. Well, so, again, that's my interpretation, but also they probably used better teams of people more at the state of the art of reinforcement learning and things like that. But that, I mean, we don't know, we only see the end result. Yes, I will send my, well, actually my email is on the slide. I don't know if you have the PDF, but on the first slide, so it's benjamin.dono@rt-france.com. So if someone wanted my email, it's either on the first page on the, of the slide or on the, I think if you click on my name, you should be able to see it. So the next question is about quantum computing and power systems. So as far as I know, quantum computing doesn't really, well, is not really industrial at the moment. So I would not imagine that some TSO or some people would use quantum computing today. But as a research topic, it would for sure probably be interesting. For example, I know that quantum computing can be used for some AI training. So of course it could be interesting here. But more generally, quantum computing would also be interesting for more generic optimization problem that are solved by TSO on a daily basis. So yeah, probably there are some room for quantum computing, but I don't know if it will work or not, but I would say that yes, it's something that could be of use there. But again, I'm not a specialist, neither in in quantum computing, so I'm not sure there, but probably there would be any interest or incentive to use it. Okay, so I don't see any more. Oh, just one question just pop up. So this question is about the modeling of the cascading failure phenomenon. So cascading failure is when a power line disconnects because too much flows on it, and then protection disconnects the power line. Then all these flows will be dispatched or be reported elsewhere, and then these other power lines will disconnect for the same reason, etc., etc. And yes, we tried to emulate this kind of phenomenon into our framework, but we had some limitation. For example, in the solver that we use a power flow solver and not a dynamic simulation solver. And so a power flow assume a steady state, and of course cascading failure is heavily dependent on time simulation. So it might be an approximation. So I would say we tried to emulate this phenomenon, but we didn't fully capture the simulation of it. But if any solver is able to do that, we would be, of course, really happy to use it. Yeah. But we didn't add one at the time. Okay, so I'm I think I still have 1 minute, so if there is no more question. No. Okay, so thank you very much. And of course, you can contact me using my my email address. That again is at the first slide on the, it's noted on the bottom of the first slide. And I wish you a really nice day and a nice conference. Thanks, and thanks for the organizers. Goodbye.